Say what? I'm just going in the mall.
Welcome to Jacksonville, Florida, and today we're going to take a look at some forgotten malls in the area. To start, we'll have a look at the Kingdom Plaza, which was long ago known as the Normandy Mall. Normandy Mall started in 1963 as a very early enclosed mall. In fact, it was the second in Florida, and one of the first in Jacksonville. The brain behind the mall would be Eddie DeBartolo. The mall would also feature a Montgomery Ward as its main anchor with Woolco as a secondary. At first, things were going well, and even the cometh of Regency Square Mall and Orange Park Mall failed to do this mall in at first. But as the 80s and 90s came in, the mall started to go through a period of decline. The closing of Montgomery Ward in 1988 was a serious blow to not just the mall, but the surrounding area. And by now, its competition was beginning to beat it out. To make matters worse, the avenues would open up and siphon more traffic away from the Normandy Mall. The mall would close in the 90s as it became largely vacant and would proceed to lose Sam's Club, whom had come in to replace Woolco early on. Things were bleak for the Normandy Mall, with only the Ward's building being repurposed into a strip mall at first. But then, in 2003, a miracle happened. Potter's House Christian Fellowship acquired the mall property for a small loan of $4 million. They then proceeded with a multi-million dollar overhaul of the mall, demolishing part of it and splitting the mall in two. One half would become home to a new megachurch, while the other half would remain a shopping mall. In 2007, this portion would reopen formally with a bowling alley, bowling shop, fitness center, and a number of smaller shops. Potter's House would even bring in the Soul Food Bistro, providing a place to eat on select days. And last but not least, this new space would be renamed into the Kingdom Plaza, a small reference to God's kingdom, if you will. Florida is full of repurposed malls like these. Even for its population figures, there were just too many malls built. But a decent number of them do find a new life in the end. This little community center hosted by the church is just one of many examples out there. And, since this is a double feature, we'll take a look at the repurposing of another mall into office centers also in Jacksonville. So, let's get back on the road and check out our next stop. And now our second stop in Jacksonville, the San Marco East Plaza. While it might not look like it now, this was once a prominent open-air mall known as the Phillips Highway Plaza. And boy, does it have a story of its own. Phillips Highway Plaza goes as far back as the late 1950s, with an old company known as Food Fair Properties aiming to bring a new shopping concept to northern Florida, of which they had already established in other parts of Florida. They eyed a particular plot of land that would put them right next to the shiny new freeway, Interstate 95. The acquisition would be done, and $7 million would be committed to the project as they planned to bring in the area's first Montgomery Ward as the main anchor. Talks were also in place to bring a Saks Fifth Avenue and Richards, though these plans fell through. A bit too ambitious to bring in a Saks, if you ask me. In the end, the anchor lineup would consist of Ward's, Food Fair, Woolworth, and S.H. Kress as this mall opened up in 1960. And before you ask, yes, this was once an enclosed mall. Unfortunately, the mall's success was short-lived, and already by the 80s, J.M. Fields, Woolworth, and Pantry Pride, whom had replaced Food Fair, would have departed the mall. Additionally, the mall would be emptying out with tenants. Something had to be done. And in 1984, the mall would be purchased by a company called Levi Schlesinger Companies. Pardon if I didn't pronounce it correctly. No one tells me until after. Regardless, this new owner did, indeed, do something. And that something started with rebranding the mall as Market Square Mall and renovating the mall into an outlet center. This new Market Square Mall would be opened up with a grand reopening in November of 1985. Unfortunately, this idea didn't catch on with Jacksonville, and the Avenues Mall would steal more potential shoppers away from the mall. Once again, vacancies climbed, and the surrounding retail corridor even began to decline. The final holdout for the mall was an Oshman's sporting goods store, which had replaced Woolworth. And in 1995, that store finally closed at the mall. This left just a mere 10 tenants at the mall. In 1996, Charles Price and Craig Meek would purchase the mall and begin converting it into a warehouse and distribution center. And a few years later, they announced their plans to repurpose the building into an office complex. This redevelopment would consist of ripping the mall's roof off and dividing the complex into 8 buildings. This ultimately brought the mall to what we have today. And even that was struggling to get off the ground, with these problems being attributed to the Holiday Inn off-site. This hotel was eventually deemed as an illegal warehouse and drug dealership by the city councilwoman at the time, Suzanne Jenkins. Very quickly, this hotel would be shut and demolished in 2001. This ended up proving to be a good move, as the office center began to take off, with Wachovia opening an office branch in the former Montgomery Ward, and Montelli Property Group going in as well. And as more office tenants moved in, it would begin to bring us to the San Marco East today. While tenants have come and gone, the offices were still occupied and in use, though there's no telling how 2020 and beyond will affect this business center's operations. Like with the remains of the Quenby Mall in Albemarle, North Carolina, this video is going to be more reserved for the hardcore mall enthusiasts in the field. While the history on both of these properties are rich and interesting, the malls themselves in their current forms are just not that much to look at. It is doubtful you'll be seeing any personality cultists from the Northeast coming here. But once again, someone has to tell these malls' stories. And until more take interest, I am that someone for the time being. Oftentimes, I go into repurposed malls like these and wonder why more of these don't exist. Well, doing a little bit of research, I think I might have a few answers I'd like to share. The most common two is that the owners just can't bring anything together to make the redevelopment plan work, or they just don't care and are more content to use the failed property as a tax write-off. But more options to consider is that the tenants in the mall might not want the transformation and would rather run their leases down first. Some anchor tenants might have clauses in their agreements that can prevent redevelopment from happening. I recall Sears and JCPenney hanging up multiple redevelopment plans across the country, even after they close. And sometimes, an outparcel on the property can set up agreements that single-handedly kill off malls altogether. Walmart and Swansea Mall are the most notorious example, of which is a place I will never get to see in person. Thanks, Wally World. Would you look at that? We're already done with these two. I want to thank you for joining me in looking at two forgotten malls in Jacksonville. And until next time, this is Doomy Grunt wishing you, the Kingdom Plaza, and the San Marco East Plaza, farewell, and good luck.